The first objection then is that donating to aid agencies is an ineffective way to combat global poverty. As I indicated already, this is an objection to premise three. Different objections might be objections to different premises, but this in particular seems to challenge premise three, holding that premise three is false. People in support of this sort of objection will say things such as, giving people food or money causes dependency. I found it quite common that in response to Singer's argument, people will often say things like, if you give a man a fish, he'll eat for a day. But if you teach a man to fish, he'll eat for a lifetime. Because they take Singer to be advocating handouts of either in the form of food or of money to the global poor. Something else people often say is aid agencies use money wastefully, that their administrative costs are too high. And one other thing that people often say is that corruption in poor countries makes it impossible to reduce poverty through aid. I want to pose a question to you all. I know so far you're just sitting there silently, but I want to actually pose a question to you all now, in response to which you wouldn't simply raise your hands, but you might actually say something. How do you think Singer could possibly respond to this? Does this strike you as an insurmountable objection that defeats Singer's position, or does it seem to you that Singer might have some response that could be made to this objection? Any thoughts about what Singer might say in response? Yeah, back in the green shirt.
I think that Singer could maybe say that the handouts I think people are referring to, the people who like make $30,000 a year in the United States, these people live on $700 a year because they're dying, they're starving, the mosquitoes are dying, they're killing them, they got malaria and measles, and I think you can spare $10 is what Singer would probably say.
Right. Certainly I think Singer would say, it wouldn't cost, I mean, even though many people in the United States suffer from the effects of economic inequality, obviously the wealth disparities I was talking about earlier in the talk, that's not just happening in the rest of the world between countries, but it's also happening within countries, including the United States, where there are substantial wealth disparities. But even among people who are on the lower end of the income scale in the United States, what would amount, Singer might say, to a modest sacrifice to them could make the difference between life and death for someone in an extremely poor country who lives on less than the severe poverty line. But the objection seems to say this: you might give some of your income, say you yourself barely live above the poverty line in the United States, you might give $10 or $20 to Oxfam. But the objection seems to say this: why would you give your $10 or $20 to Oxfam? Oxfam, perhaps, will use the money inefficiently. They spend too much money on marketing materials or paying the salaries of their executives. Or, despite Oxfam's best efforts, corruption and political instability in third world countries will prevent your donation from being fully effective. How can Singer respond to that challenge? Good, right. So what I think Singer could say here is that, no, it would be wrong for us to be too optimistic about the potential of monetary donations to alleviate global poverty. No one person, certainly on their own, is going to be able to eradicate the world of global poverty. Even Bill Gates could give away 90% of his wealth and he'd still actually be among the wealthiest people in the United States, but that wouldn't do quite enough to completely eradicate global poverty. But what Singer might say, and this is echoed in your response, is that it's true that aid can have unintended consequences, for example, causing dependency, that some aid agencies use donations ineffectively, and that obstacles internal to poor countries may in some cases undermine the efficacy of aid. However, this only shows that aid is sometimes less effective than we might hope. In order to ultimately defeat premise three, what this objection would have to show is something far more extreme. And the burden of proof would seemingly be on the objector to show that not only is it the case that aid is sometimes less effective than we might hope, but it's not effective at all. In other words, if you gave $100 to Oxfam and they managed only to use that money to pay for half of the cost of saving one person's life due to inefficiencies in Oxfam, that would still not defeat the truth of premise three. Premise three would still be true. For example, suppose that Alice found herself next to the shallow pond and there were several children drowning all at once and there wasn't possibly enough time for her to save all of them. She couldn't possibly be fully effective in saving every single one of them. Suppose at that point she said, well, I can't be fully effective, so I'm not going to do anything at all. We would regard that as morally monstrous. We would say, well, at least save the ones you can. Even if your efforts won't be fully effective, you still have an obligation to save the lives of those who you can save, and perhaps lament the fact that you can't save them all, but nevertheless make some effort. In other words, to put the point more generally, unless one could show that such problems render donating to aid agencies wholly and completely ineffective, premise three nevertheless would be true. There's one other point that Singer can make as well, which is this. Suppose that the objection is at least in part right, that there are some forms of aid that cause problems worse than what they aim to solve, that some aid agencies are so inept and incompetent that money sent to them will be totally useless, totally misused. And suppose even that there are some countries in the world where it's totally hopeless. No one from a wealthy Western country could possibly make a donation that would improve anyone's life, owing to political obstacles and corruption in that country. Even this, Singer might say, wouldn't wholly defeat premise three. In fact, what it would do is it would show that we have a subsidiary moral obligation to investigate what aid agencies use money most effectively and what methods of aiding are most effective. In other words, this objection, despite its own intentions, doesn't show that we have fewer moral obligations than we thought we did. It shows that we have more. That we actually, in addition to donating to aid agencies, have to make sure we do so in a way that's actually effective. Although it turns out this subsidiary moral obligation isn't nearly as burdensome as you might think, because there are already organizations that do this very work for us, one of which I've mentioned here on my slide is GiveWell, whose website is givewell.org, where you can discover what aid agencies, not only with respect to global poverty, but with respect to a variety of injustices and tragedies, both domestic and global, are most effective. All right, as I said, there are several objections on the handout, and you may feel compelled by some of these, so I encourage you to ask me about them in the question and answer period. But what I want to do now is turn to the last portion of this talk to look at a different perspective on the topic of global poverty. So pardon me while I skip several slides here. Here we go. Remember that Singer's stark and controversial conclusion derives from what we call his principle of beneficence. If it's in your power to prevent something bad from happening without sacrificing anything nearly as important, then morally you ought to do so. It's wrong not to do so. And he derived this principle from our intuitive reactions to cases like those of Alice, Bob, and Carl. In each case, we thought, despite the fact that Alice, Bob, and Carl would incur some sacrifice to themselves, some cost to their welfare, they nevertheless have a moral obligation to save the person who's in danger, because the person who's in danger is facing something far worse than what they themselves are facing by making the effort to rescue them. What the principle of beneficence establishes is what in philosophy is called a positive duty. positive duty is a duty to benefit others or to shield them from harms caused by third parties. I'd like you to consider one final thought experiment now in the case of Ellen. Ellen heads to her neighborhood pool to enjoy a day of relaxation. Upon arrival, she finds a toddler sleeping in the only lounge chair that's shaded. Now, Ellen had really hoped to sit there. So she scoops the toddler up and tosses him into the deep end of the pool. It quickly becomes apparent that the toddler cannot swim. Nevertheless, Ellen takes her seat and tries to relax in spite of all the commotion. Has Ellen acted wrongly?
Yes.
Okay. Everyone thinks so. Good. You're good moral people. Now, there's something, many things funny about this case, but philosophically, one thing that's significant is that, indeed, yes, of course, Ellen has acted wrongly. She's a terrible person. But Ellen has not violated a positive duty to the toddler. She hasn't violated a positive duty to benefit the toddler or to shield him from harms caused by someone else, as Alice would have, had she declined to save the child that she came upon drowning in the shallow pond. Ellen's moral relation to the toddler is very different from the moral relation between Alice and the baby that she finds struggling in the shallow pond. Ellen, unlike Alice, should she have declined to save the baby in the pond, has instead violated a negative duty, a duty to ensure that others are not unduly harmed through one's own conduct. All right, so we have a philosophical distinction here between negative and positive duties. On the one hand, a positive duty is a duty to benefit or to aid someone, to assist them, to help. Whereas a negative duty is simply a duty not to harm. And it's usually accompanied by what we call a duty of redress or a duty of rectification. That is to say, if you violate a negative duty to someone else, you harm them unduly, then not only have you already done something wrong, but you have to make it right again. You have a further consequent moral obligation to compensate the person, to restore the person, to replace them in the condition either where they were before your action or where they would have been had you not so acted. But here's something interesting. The cases of Alice, Bob, and Carl, remember, Singer uses these to model our moral obligations to the global poor. They suggest that wealthy countries morally are like Alice, Bob, and Carl. Singer uses the case of Alice, Bob, and Carl as not only means for generating moral intuitions about what is right and what's wrong more generally to support the principle of beneficence, but they're also clearly acting as a kind of analogy or model for our moral relation with people who are poor, suffering from severe poverty in the global south. And what these models, the cases of Alice, Bob, and Carl suggest, is that they are mere bystanders whose ability to help those in need is causally unrelated to those they might save. Think about Alice, Bob, and Carl. They're all good Samaritans, should they actually save the person. They come upon, literally in one case, a stranger by the side of the road who's in need of help. But none of them are responsible for the harms that person will suffer should they fail to assist them. Another philosopher, Thomas Pogge, writes that wealthy countries, however, are not mere bystanders like Alice, Bob, and Carl, who by coincidence possess the means to save the global poor through acts of beneficence. Instead, Pogge says, wealthy countries are morally much more similar to Ellen than they are to Alice, Bob, and Carl. Now, I can tell from your reaction you all thought that Ellen had done something far worse than Alice, Bob, or Carl would have had they failed to save the person who was in need. And And that tells us something about morality, that we tend to think of the violation of a negative duty as something that's far worse morally than the violation of a positive duty. That it's far worse to cause someone undue harm through your own conduct than it is merely to fail to aid them, to fail to assist them, even when the consequences are exactly the same. Notice that one parallel between the case of Alice and the case of Ellen is the outcome is the same. A child dies. But we still thought Ellen did something worse than Alice would have had she not saved the child, because of her moral relationship to the child. Ellen actually put the child in the situation of danger, whereas Alice simply came upon the child already in a state of danger. Again, it's Pokey's contention that wealthy countries are much more like Ellen than they are Alice, Bob, and Carl. But this is controversial in a way that Singer's argument does not seem to be. So what does he say in support of this? According to Pokey, wealthy countries have a certain moral relationship with poor countries of the global south, such that even though he agrees with Singer that we do have indeed a moral duty to eradicate severe poverty globally, our duty is a negative one rather than a positive one. That is, it's a duty to not unduly harm through our own conduct, and a consequent duty to redress harms that we have already caused. In other words, you might say, this is a duty of justice, according to Pokey, rather than a duty of beneficence. One that, even from the connotations of the word alone, I think you can see, is something that we would normally regard as far more stringent. Now, in support of this controversial view, Pokey marshals quite a bit of evidence, and I want to highlight some of it for you here. But quickly I'll mention, his general argument is this. Wealthy Western countries actively cause severe poverty globally through their control of global economic institutions. Institutions such as the World Trade Organization, the World Bank, and the International Monetary Fund. And he provides several examples of these. I'll just highlight a few. One is what he calls the international resource privilege. This is something that you may not have thought about before, but it's quite striking. Any group controlling a preponderance of the means of coercion within a country is internationally recognized as the legitimate government of that country's territory and people, regardless of how it came to power, how it rules, whether it is supported by the population it governs or not. Western corporations routinely make purchases from authoritarian military dictators of resources and then subsequently use them to make products which they sell to us for profits. What's interesting here, Pokey comments, is that if we thought about this in terms of an analogy, imagine that a group of bandits breaks into an electronics warehouse and steals all of the stuff inside, and then they sell those electronics on the black market to other people. Would we normally regard those other people as the legitimate owners of those electronics? Well, of course not, because the people they got them from didn't have a legitimate claim to ownership on them in the first place. They stole them. And so Pokey says Western corporations are like these other people who have purchased their resources from military dictators who, in the analogy, are analogous to the bandits who broke into the warehouse. We regard them as the legitimate moral owners, even though in the domestic analogy, we would never regard the equivalent parties as the actual owner. Nevertheless, we treat anyone who manages to possess a monopoly on the use of coercion within a country's boundaries as its legitimate leader and authorized to sell its resources on the country's behalf. As Pokey points out, this not only upholds the power of dictators to oppress their people, it also creates incentives for political and military instability. Think back to the objection to Singer's view we talked about a few moments ago. One of the reasons that people say giving to aid agencies is ineffective is that corruption in poor countries makes it impossible to aid effectively. One thing we never, very often do not ask ourselves is, why is there so much corruption and political instability in poor countries such that we can't effectively aid them? Well, one of the reasons for it is the international resource privilege, which Western countries and Western corporations have a hand in upholding. In other words, this political instability and corruption in poor countries of the global South, it doesn't come from nowhere. It has causes, and the causes themselves are global and implicate people and institutions around the world, including in Western countries. Another example is the international borrowing privilege. It allows military dictators to borrow in their country's name, even if they intend to use the money to finance vanity projects or to expand their military power. Again, anyone who manages to come to have a monopoly on the use of coercion within a country's boundaries is regarded as its legitimate ruler, and thus can borrow in the country's name from institutions such as the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank. But successor governments, even if fully democratic and just, are required to service these debts on pain of being excluded from international financial markets and loss of borrowing privilege, even when it keeps their country in extreme poverty. One thing that we often don't think about when people worry that we give too much foreign aid to poor countries is that in comparison to the amount that poor countries are made to pay in debt service every year to us, it's as if we offer them a thimble full of water and in return we want back several bathtubs worth. If you compare the amount of debt service payments poor countries give to us to the amount of foreign aid that we give them. And so the flow of resources is disproportionately from them to us rather than us to them, despite meager amounts of foreign aid that are given out. Like the international resource privilege, the international borrowing privilege creates incentives for political and military instability. Obviously, the reason for this is that if you can come to have this kind of power, have an international resource privilege, an international borrowing privilege, this creates an incentive. If you don't have to be a democratically authorized ruler, but anyone who manages to control the military within the territory can actually have the international resource and borrowing privileges, then that creates an incentive for people to stage military coups. Let me say something about trade tariffs. Wealthy countries charge poor countries tariffs on imports that are four times greater than tariffs on imports from other wealthy countries. Pogge gets this statistic from The Economist magazine, and if you don't know The Economist, they're champions of the WTO and what's called free trade. But The Economist itself estimates that this costs the economy of poor countries $700 billion per year. Now think back to a statistic I gave you at the beginning of this talk. For slightly less than $300 billion, we could eradicate severe poverty globally. This is more than twice that amount that's being cost poor countries just in terms of unequal trade tariffs. And my last example I'll mention is what is appropriately called TRIPS, which stands for the Trade-Related Aspects of Intellectual Property Rights, component of the WTO treaty that has deprived millions of patients in poor countries access to generic versions of advanced medicines, for example, for treating AIDS. These medicines, in fact, had been cheaply available in poor countries prior to TRIPS, the purpose of which was to protect the intellectual property rights of Western pharmaceutical corporations. So Western pharmaceutical corporations were worried that their intellectual property rights were being infringed, and so the WTO stepped in to block the sale of generic drugs in poor countries. Drugs that the people there could actually afford. Instead, now you've got major Western pharmaceutical companies selling these drugs at prices, of course, that people in poor countries can't afford because they no longer have access to the generics. Now, in conclusion, I just want to ask a question. Why does it matter whether we understand the duty to eradicate global poverty as positive or negative? This has both philosophical and practical implications, whether we understand this duty as one of beneficence, assistance, or aid, or whether we understand it rather as not unduly harming people and redressing the harms we've already caused. Philosophically, conceiving of the duty negatively avoids altogether objections that a positive conception of the duty must overcome. If any of you have questions about these objections, I'll explain this point in relation to them. But just recall for a moment our reactions to the cases of Alice, Bob, Carl, in comparison to our reaction to the case of Ellen. It seemed to us that it was far worse what Ellen had done than what Alice, Bob, and Carl might have done. And so, conceiving of the duty negatively successfully establishes a much stronger moral duty. That is to say, we would regard what we are obligated to do as far more stringent if we understand the duty as Pogge wants us to, in terms of a negative duty of justice rather than a positive duty of beneficence. Our failure to comply with this duty would be a far greater moral failing, much more like Ellen's, than it would be like Alice's had she simply failed to rescue the child. But there's a practical implication as well. A negative conception of the duty entails that discharging it is less a matter of individual level beneficence. For example, as Singer recommends, each of us going home tonight and supplying Oxfam with our credit card number on the website, oxfam.org. But discharging of the duty to eradicate global poverty requires, on the negative conception, something very different in character. Namely, working to bring about structural changes to the institutions that comprise the global economy, the very institutions such as the WTO, IMF, and World Bank, that cause severe poverty around the world. In other words, what would be required of us on a negative duty is something far different and involves a kind of political, concerted collective political action rather than individual level beneficence that we could undertake by ourselves in the privacy and comfort of our homes. So I'd like to close tonight by thanking you for your attention and also expressing my wish that I feel depressed right now. Thank you. Than the tariffs between wealthy countries. Another thing that I think Pogge would recommend is the forgiving what's called the Southern debt. Debts that poor countries incurred in the 1980s when they borrowed to promote human development projects in their countries when global interest rates were quite low. Those interest rates spiked in the early to mid-1980s, and they've actually caused poor countries' debts to multiply by hundreds of times, despite the fact that they're making debt payments. A lot of rich countries, in response to this, and in order to avoid global economic collapse, imposed on poor countries what are called structural adjustment policies. These are policies whose purpose is to reorient the economies of poor countries away from production intended to satisfy the needs of local people and toward production intended to supply goods for export on the global market. So what you find is a lot of poor countries, for example, chronic malnutrition is a problem in lots of poor countries, but not because they're not capable of growing food to feed the people who live there. It's because they're selling all of their food on the global market in order to comply with the structural adjustment policies that wealthy countries have imposed on them through the International Monetary Fund and World Bank. You find this throughout the world for poor countries. So one thing Pogge would simply say is we ought to forgive the debts of the global south. Now, there are questions about what it would mean to forgive and whether or not the debts were justly incurred in the first place. But nevertheless, Pogge would say certain things we ought to do include reform to the global structures, to the structures of the global economy, including what you mentioned, the global resources dividend that Pogge produced, that Pogge advocates as a kind of tax on natural resource use, which could collect funds for the sake of eradicating global poverty in different parts of the world.
Are there other questions? Yes, stand up.
Utilitarianism applied to the problem of global poverty would say that we each have moral obligations to give to the point at which we would make ourselves worse off than the people we intend to help through our donations. Because utilitarianism says you have to maximize happiness. And so, and you have to do so giving others interest equal weight. Thus, we would have no room on utilitarianism for any kind of special regard for ourselves. But Singer doesn't, even though Singer is a utilitarian, and that's what leads Singer himself to the principle of beneficence, the reason he doesn't want to give a more complex or deeper philosophical justification is, of course, many people would not accept utilitarianism. But the principle of beneficence is something that could be accepted on a variety of different moral grounds. For example, the chief rival to utilitarianism in Western ethics, Kantian ethics, can also support the principle of beneficence, something that Kant himself recognizes. For those of you familiar, Kant's moral theory says that it's impermissible to act in ways that it's inconceivable that everyone else could also act. In other words, you're not permitted to make an exception of yourself, to follow rules, which it's not conceivable that everyone else could follow at the same time. Now, Kant himself says that this principle, which he calls the categorical imperative, generates what he calls an imperfect duty to be beneficent, to help other people. It's not nearly as stringent as the demand that utilitarianism makes, but nevertheless, it would support the principle of beneficence that Singer has in his argument. And thus, Singer wants to leave it this principle vague enough that from a variety of different moral positions, including, for example, rather than the secular moral positions I've been describing, a religious moral justification as well could be given for the principle of beneficence. To donate effectively, Singer would say there's no moral obligation. So in the case of the shallow pond, if the shallow pond were a mile from where Alice is and she was only seeing the child drowning through binoculars, but there was no way that she could run there fast enough before the child would drown, he wouldn't say that she has an obligation to run as fast as she could anyway. If she could somehow know that she couldn't get there in time, then he would say, well, there's no obligation to run to get there if you already know that you can't be effective. And so, if there were a situation where it was truly the case that voting would be ineffective, and we could know that, that's the tricky part, know that in advance, then Singer would say there's no obligation. But of course, that might just mean that we shouldn't give to some particular organization, or we shouldn't give to efforts to aid in some particular country if there are internal obstacles blocking the effectiveness of aid. That would still leave us with the possibility of making other donations to other organizations, to other countries, that stand a better chance of being effective.
About
one more question.
What would you say about punitive sanctions from the United Nations? It seems like he doesn't talk about, or you hadn't talked about that.
Pogge certainly thinks, and I think it's suggested by what he says about the international resource and international borrowing privileges, that clearly something is problematic in the fact that we recognize anyone who comes to control the means of coercion within a country as its legitimate ruler. And so sanctions seem like one means that might often be used to avoid endowing someone with an international resource or borrowing privilege if they're not an authorized democratic ruler of a country. Pogge is not a utilitarian like Singer, and so he wouldn't judge whether or not we ought to impose sanctions on such countries purely by their consequences. Singer, for example, might say, well, we should look at the history of sanctions, see whether or not they've been successful, and if they have, then we should impose them. If they haven't, then we need to find some other way. Pogge wouldn't look at it purely in terms of consequences since he's not a utilitarian. But nevertheless, I think in this case, he would say, surely the consequences of them are what matters. And so it would be a matter, and this goes beyond me, I wish I had a political scientist up on stage with me who could more effectively talk about types of sanctions that have been used and their effectiveness. I think, you know, there's probably very good reason to be skeptical about the effectiveness of sanctions. But nevertheless, the situation calls for some measures that are designed in the same spirit as sanctions to avoid endowing illegitimate leaders with an international borrowing and resource.
We have one more question for you. Do you think I see how a lot of this is going towards saving lives.
Yeah, that's an interesting question. Thank you. What Singer would say is this. It's probably only in emergency cases that what we should be doing is getting food or money. That in the vast majority of cases, you know, say in response to natural disasters like earthquakes that have just occurred, in cases like that, the most effective form of aid is probably food or medical resources. But Singer would say the most effective way, and I think here Pogge would agree, because Pogge certainly wouldn't say that. Pogge would say even though we need reform to the structures of the global economy, that's hard to achieve and would take a long time. So maybe in the meantime we ought to do some giving as well. But nevertheless, we ought to use forms of aid for giving donations. We ought to support organizations that go beyond simply giving food or money directly to poor people. Rather, we should give donations to organizations that use the money to bring about structural changes, say building schools or hospitals or infrastructure in poor countries. One of the primary problems causing disease in poor countries to claim people's lives, diseases that don't affect people really here in the United States, is that there's simply not the infrastructure in place to deliver medical resources to places throughout the world where they're most needed. And so there are some organizations that just seek to get the medical resources to the places where people need them. That's what they do. And they don't actually supply the resources themselves. They just transport them to the places that they're not getting to right now. And so those sorts of things, I think both Singer and Pogge would agree, are going to be more effective in the long run. But we wouldn't want to use those in emergency cases because they're not going to address the problem in emergency cases. So including access to medicines and ensuring that women have reproductive autonomy through access to birth control and condoms. One thing that's interesting, just to close with this thought tonight, is that people often think that part of the reason there's so much poverty in the world is overpopulation. But actually, the relationship between poverty and overpopulation is somewhat different than we typically think of it to be. It's not so much overpopulation that causes poverty, but overpopulation is an effect of poverty. And so if we can reduce poverty, that will also reduce the rate of population increase. And there are a couple of reasons for this. One is that, I mentioned earlier in the talk, 70% of the world's poor are women. And one aspect of their poverty is a lack of social power, a lack of power in their societies, owing to which they often lack reproductive autonomy. Thus, they don't have the power to refuse sex, and they don't have the power to insist on condom use. And so by bringing those women out of poverty, it would actually instill them with the capability of reproductive autonomy, and thus have the effect of reducing population increase. Another reason that poverty causes overpopulation is in countries such as in Africa, they don't have social security systems run by the government that are going to take care of them in old age. And significant portions of their children die in childhood. Many die later before reaching adulthood. And so the absence of a social safety net in those countries provides an incentive. It makes it rational, in other words, for them to have larger families than we have, because so many of their children will probably die before they reach old age if they're so lucky themselves. And there's no social safety net that they have to have more children than we normally would, just to make sure there's someone who will take care of them in old age. And so the poverty provides an incentive to have more children than people in Western countries have. And we can see there's a correlation between when countries' economic position improves in the global order, the birth rate goes down. And so, in fact, the relation is quite the opposite of what we normally take it to be. Rather than it being overpopulation that causes poverty, it's poverty that causes overpopulation. And so if we're concerned about those sorts of things, what we want to do is combat poverty first, which will achieve the effect of reducing population growth.
If you're like I am,